Welcome to this presentation. This will be a lecture on forensic psychiatry. This would be the lecture outline. After an introduction, we will go through 8 topics in forensic psychiatry. As usual, we will conclude with a set of 5 multiple choice questions based on the material covered. The 8 forensic psychiatry topics that I will be attempting to cover are violence and mental disorders, fitness to plead and competence to stand trial, insanity defense, pathological jealousy, stalking, arson and pyromania, testamentary capacity, and risk assessment. In this slide, I have given the definition of forensic as per the Oxford and Merriam-Webster dictionaries. And in this slide, I have given the definition and description of forensic psychiatry as per the American Academy of Psychiatry and the Law. Those who are interested can pause and note down the details. And in this slide, I have given the definition and description of forensic psychiatry as per the Royal College of Psychiatrists. A forensic psychiatrist is typically involved in the assessment and management of mentally disordered individuals who have either already offended or are considered very high risk of committing an offense. A forensic psychiatrist is expected to have a thorough grasp of the legal issues that are relevant to psychiatry. The forensic psychiatrist is regarded by the court as an expert witness, and his or her oral testimony and or written report may be crucial in determining the outcome of a case. As a result, the same case may have 2 forensic psychiatrists providing diametrically opposite opinions. Specialist forensic psychiatry services are not available in many resource-limited countries, so it is useful for general psychiatrists to have a basic understanding of some of the important topics in forensic psychiatry. The first topic is violence and mental disorders. Violent acts committed by the mentally ill get disproportionate media attention, and this contributes significantly towards a general stigmatization of all patients. But mental illness directly accounts for only a very small proportion of all violent crimes. In fact, the mentally ill as a group are more likely to be victims of violence than the general population. The main risk factors for violence, both in the general population and among the mentally ill, are historical, demographic, and psychosocial factors such as past history of violence, male gender, adolescence and young adult age group, lower socioeconomic status, alcohol and substance misuse, childhood conduct disorder, and adult antisocial personality disorder. Among psychotic individuals, threat control override or TCO symptoms have been associated with risk of violence. TCO symptoms mainly refer to delusions in which patients feel under imminent threat or that they are being controlled and overridden from outside. Examples: delusions that someone is plotting to harm or kill them, passivity delusions that one's thoughts and actions are being remotely controlled. Patients with TCO symptoms may act violently in order to remove the threat and regain control. If a specific individual is being blamed by the patient as being responsible, then there is an increased risk of the patient being violent towards that person. Command hallucinations have also been linked to violence. Usually, the victims of such violent acts by patients are those known to the patient. Studies in different countries suggest that between 5 and 10% of all homicides are committed by psychotic individuals. Assuming a prevalence rate of psychosis of 1 to 2% in the general population, this suggests that psychosis is associated with about a 5-fold increased risk. As with other violent crimes, a major proportion of this increased risk is attributable to comorbid alcohol and substance misuse and personality disorder. More than a third of these homicides are committed during the first episode of psychosis, usually before any contact with psychiatric services. The risk of homicide is significantly reduced once treatment is initiated. Changes in the nature and degree of psychotic symptoms have been shown to increase the risk. As homicide is a rare event, prediction at an individual patient level is very difficult, but one can expect an overall decrease in homicides by psychotic patients if psychoses are detected early and treated effectively. It is very rare for psychotic subjects to kill strangers. Women who commit homicide are more likely to be mentally ill at the time of the homicide compared to men who commit homicide. Women who commit homicide are also more likely to commit suicide soon after. Postpartum psychosis, especially with prominent depressive symptoms, is associated with risk of infanticide and maternal suicide. In homicide suicide, the perpetrator commits the homicide and then commits suicide. Typically, the perpetrator is a man and the victim is his wife. A whole family can be killed by homicide suicide. A pending divorce or a recent separation initiated by the female partner is a well-recognized trigger. Prior to the homicide suicide, the male may threaten to kill the wife if she leaves the relationship or may indulge in stalking if she has left him. Another scenario is an elderly controlling husband killing his ill wife and then himself. In a proportion, an underlying mental disorder is present and may account for the homicide-suicide. Availability of firearms has been associated with an increased risk of homicide-suicide.
The next topic is fitness to plead. Fitness to plead is a concept used in the UK and many Commonwealth nations and refers to a defendant's ability to properly defend oneself in court. The equivalent notion in the US is competence to stand trial. Any defendant is considered fit to plead unless it can be proven otherwise. If there are concerns about the defendant's fitness to plead, the court can request a formal assessment by a psychiatrist, usually prior to the trial. The defendant may need to be admitted to a psychiatric hospital for this assessment and for treatment to try to restore fitness. Fitness to plead applies to the state of mind of the accused at the time of the trial and not the time of the alleged crime. A defendant is said to have fitness to plead if he or she is able at a very basic level to understand the charges and decide whether to plead guilty or not, instruct one's legal counsel, comprehend the evidence, follow the course of the trial proceedings, challenge any juror whom one may object. These are called the Pritchard criteria and they date back to 1836. In summary, the defendant should possess the basic intellect to both understand the relevant issues and communicate his or her views. Historically, deaf mutes were considered unfit to plead. Competence to stand trial is the US equivalent of fitness to plead. A defendant is said to have CST if he or she is able at present to a reasonable degree understand both factually and rationally the proceedings of the trial, and assist their attorney in one's defense. The above are called the dusky criteria. These criteria are concerned with a defendant's capacity to stand trial and not the defendant's willingness to stand trial. Presence of mental illness does not automatically equate with a lack of competence to stand trial. Fitness to plead is a dynamic concept. So, in an episodic mental illness like psychosis, fitness to plead is likely to be regained with treatment. However, in a stable, severe enduring disorder, such as severe intellectual disability, if the subject is unfit, the fitness is unlikely to be regained. There is a concept called trial of the facts. If the defendant is found unfit, the court might still decide to proceed with the trial in order to establish the facts. Even if this concludes that the defendant committed the crime, the judge will not record a conviction. There are different possible outcomes for unfit defendants based on the country, nature of offense, nature of the mental impairment, the type of court, the availability of forensic psychiatry services, etc. Examples of such outcomes include a release of the accused without any punishment. This is called an absolute discharge. Release of the accused into the community but with mandatory supervision. This is called a supervision order. Placement in a non-prison but high secure forensic psychiatric setting to prevent future offending. This is called a treatment order. In those deemed to be at very high risk of re-offending, the duration of stay in such a setting may far exceed any prison sentence they might have received if fit to plead and found guilty. The next topic is insanity defense. The insanity defense is related to the mental state of the defendant at the time of the alleged offense. So the insanity evaluation is a retrospective one. Insanity is a legal and not a psychiatric term. To be found guilty, both mens rea, which is guilty mind or criminal motive or intent, and actus reus, which is guilty act, need to be established. A defendant would be able to use the insanity defense if a psychiatric assessment concludes that the defendant was so severely mentally incapacitated at the time of the offense that he or she was incapable of having the mens rea to commit the crime, even if the actus reus is established beyond reasonable doubt. The McNaughton rules were outlined by the British House of Lords in 1843 following the acquittal of Daniel McNaughton, who had killed the Prime Minister's secretary after mistaking the secretary for the Prime Minister. McNaughton was found not guilty by reason of insanity and was sent to a psychiatric asylum. This outraged the British establishment, and Queen Victoria directed the House of Lords to draft stricter standards for the insanity defense. Since then, the McNaughton rules have been the broad yardsticks worldwide in cases where the insanity defense is being applied. If the McNaughton rules had been applied in McNaughton's own trial, he would not have satisfied the criteria for insanity and would have been found guilty and executed. And in this slide, I have given the wording of the McNaughton rules. If you are interested, you can pause and note down the details. The key points are that at the time of committing the act, there must have been a defect of reason from disease of the mind, and the defendant did not know the nature and quality of the act, and also did not know that what he was doing was wrong. If the insanity defense is accepted by the court, the defendant will be found not guilty by reason of insanity. In the case of homicide, the concept of diminished responsibility applies, and the person will be convicted of manslaughter and not murder. In many countries, specific infanticide laws are in place to deal leniently with mentally unwell mothers who kill their babies. Depending on the nature of the offense and other factors, numerous disposal options are available to the court. These include acquittal, a supervision order, a hospital order, a restriction order, etc. Rarely the defense of automatism may be invoked. That is, the act was a result of unconscious involuntary behavior over which the defendant had no control. Classical examples are epilepsy and sleepwalking. Automatism has been historically divided into sane or external and insane or internal types, and I have given examples for each. Apart from the McNaughton rules, other standards are sometimes applied. For example, in the United States, the following are used in some of these states. The irresistible impulse test, the Durham rule, the American Law Institute rule, and the guilty but mentally ill or GBMI standard. Structured instruments are sometimes used in the assessments of legal insanity. Usually, specific training is needed to administer these tests. An example is the Rogers Criminal Responsibility Assessment Scales, or the RCRAS. This has 30 items covering behavioral and psychological variables under 5 subgroups or scales covering psychopathology, organicity, cognitive control, behavioral control, and patient reliability. The next heading is Pathological Jealousy. Normal jealousy is a universal emotion. Jealousy and envy are related but not synonymous terms. Jealousy is evoked by the fear of losing someone that one values. Envy is evoked by the desire of something that one values but is possessed by another person. Jealousy is directed towards the person of value that one already possesses. Envy is directed at the other person who possesses what one values. The distinction between normal and pathological jealousy is not always clear. Pathological jealousy is also called morbid jealousy or Othello syndrome, based on the Shakespearean character. Pathological jealousy is generally characterized by preoccupation about the sexual infidelity of one's partner. Factors suggesting pathological jealousy include secretly following the partner, checking the partner's post, emails, phone call records, and texts, checking the partner's body for evidence of sex with another person, checking the partner's underwear for evidence of sex with another person, prominent fears of being humiliated by losing one's partner to another. Usually, only cases of severe delusional pathological jealousy come to the attention of psychiatric services. The delusion may either be part of an underlying psychiatric disorder, or it may be the only manifestation of a delusional disorder. It is mainly the latter that is referred to as pathological jealousy. Pathological jealousy is more common in males. The age of onset is later than that of schizophrenia. Even geriatric onset pathological jealousy has been recognized when organic causes also need to be considered. Sometimes preoccupations may be obsessional in nature rather than delusional. In the former, the individual has insight, is usually ashamed, but still cannot avoid repeatedly checking on the partner or placing restrictions on the partner's activities. Pathological jealousy with overvalued ideas are characteristic of paranoid personality disorders. Pathological jealousy is an important risk factor for serious aggression, including homicide. So, any threats or acts of violence made by the jealous person against their spouse or partner should be taken seriously. History of violence due to jealousy is an important risk factor for future violence, even if the partner has changed. Any comorbid alcohol or substance misuse increases the risk of such violence. If the partner is unaware of the threats made by the patient, the partner needs to be informed, and it is appropriate to breach confidentiality in such cases. Risk of harm to a third party, risk of self-harm in the patient, and adverse psychological effects on the partner and any children in the family also need to be considered. If there is an underlying psychotic disorder that sufficiently explains the pathological jealousy, then treatment with antipsychotic medication is indicated. In some cases, admission to hospital may be necessary, especially if the patient is totally lacking in insight and is at high risk of violence. If there is significant risk of harm, a period of separation may be warranted. Other treatment options for delusional pathological jealousy include other medication such as antidepressants and mood stabilizers, psychotherapy. If any potential harm is imminent and or serious, the police and social services may also need to be informed. Unfortunately, it is not uncommon for the patient to come to the attention of psychiatric services only after the damage is done. For example, an undiagnosed, untreated man with delusional pathological jealousy kills his innocent wife, is arrested, diagnosed before the trial, and admitted to a forensic psychiatry unit for treatment. The next topic is stalking. Stalking is a behavior in which an individual, the stalker, repeatedly and intrusively makes or attempts to make unwanted contact with another person, the victim, in a manner which creates fear, distress, helplessness, etc. in the victim. The stalker may indulge in the following malevolent behaviors: following the victim, loitering around the home or workplace of the victim, repeated phone calls, text messages, emails, letters, notes, and even graffiti, sending unsolicited gifts to the victim, or ordering or cancelling items on behalf of the victim, making unsubstantiated complaints, spreading unfounded rumors. Causing damage to the victim's property or even physical violence against the victim. Stalking can have a range of consequences on the victim, and I have listed some of these on this slide. Overall, at least 80% of stalkers are men and up to 80% of victims are women. Less commonly, a woman stalks a man. In a small proportion, a man stalks another man. In an even smaller proportion, a woman stalks another woman. Anyone can be a victim of stalking: ex-partners, friends, acquaintances, professional contacts, work colleagues, celebrities, or strangers. Very rarely, a victim may falsely claim that he or she is being stalked. Stalkers have been divided into five main types. This is from a classification proposed by Professor Paul Mullen, a forensic psychiatrist in Australia. We will go through the key features of each type of stalker. The rejected stalker is the most common type of stalker seen in forensic psychiatry. Up to 90% of rejected stalkers are men. The victim is typically female, usually the ex-wife or ex-partner. Stalking is used either as revenge or to force reconciliation. These stalkers typically have personality disorder, but typically do not have psychosis. The next type is the intimacy-seeking stalker. This is the only type of stalking in which the stalker is more likely to be a female. The stalker is usually a lonely person seeking a relationship. The victim may be a stranger, an acquaintance, a known health professional such as the family doctor or psychiatrist, or a celebrity. The stalker may have erotomanic delusions that the victim is deeply in love with her. This is also called de Clairembault syndrome. These stalkers tend to be very persistent, but violence is unusual. The next type is the predatory stalker. These stalkers are almost always men. It is associated with sexually deviant behavior and sexual offending. The stalker chooses the victim, follows the victim, systematically gathers information about the victim, and sexually assaults the victim after careful planning. Serial rapists and serial child molesters display predatory stalking. Predatory stalkers gain sadistic pleasure from the control they are able to exercise over the unsuspecting and helpless victims. Unlike the other four types, the resentful stalker has no desire for any kind of a personal relationship with the victim. The stalker typically is a paranoid man who feels without any basis that he has been unjustly treated by the victim. The main aim of the stalker is to harass the victim. The stalker tends to feel self-righteous that he is fighting a powerful oppressor. A group of stalkers may stalk a group of victims in an organized way. They frequently also resort to harassment via social media and other online platforms, and this is called cyber stalking. Examples of resentful stalkers include animal rights activists stalking researchers doing animal experiments, a political activist stalking a politician with a different ideology. The final type of stalker is the incompetent suitor. This type of stalker is typically a male who has poor social skills. The victim is usually female, either a stranger or a casual acquaintance that the stalker is attracted to. The main motivation for the stalking is to establish a brief relationship with the victim. The stalker is unable or unwilling to understand that the victim is not interested. After some time, the stalker loses interest in this victim, but may soon move on to harass another. This type of stalking is likely to be common in the community, but most cases do not come to the attention of psychiatric services. We now move on to arson and pyromania. Arson is a major crime. In the US, it is a felony and not a misdemeanor. Arson is an easy crime to commit, needs no weapon, accomplice, or physical victim. The word arson is derived from Latin ardere, which means to burn. Fire setting, arson and pyromania are related but not synonymous terms. Fire setting is an act, arson is a legal term, and pyromania is a diagnosis in both ICD and DSM. Not all fire setting is arson. Only deliberate fire setting with criminal intent is arson. Arson does not include accidental fire setting or unpredictable spread of an innocuous fire. Not all arsonists satisfy criteria for pyromania. So, arsonists are a subset of fire setters, while pyromaniacs are a subset of arsonists. Risk factors for arson include male gender, late adolescence and early adulthood age group, living alone and single marital status, lower levels of education, unemployment, nighttime, weekends, urban areas. Compared to the general population, arsonists have higher rates of alcohol and substance misuse, intellectual disability and pervasive developmental disorders, psychotic disorders, antisocial personality disorders, mood and anxiety disorders, history of sexual abuse and other impulse control disorders such as gambling. Pyromania is included in ICD-10 under category F63.1. The main category is disorders of adult personality and behavior, and the subcategory is habit and impulse disorders. So, an ICD-10 diagnosis of pyromania requires at least 2 acts of fire setting without any apparent motive, an intense urge to set fire to objects, a feeling of tension before fire setting, and a relief from the tension after fire setting, and preoccupation with thoughts or mental images of fire setting or of issues relating to fire. Pyromania is also a diagnosis in DSM-5. The main category is disruptive impulse control and conduct disorders, and the criteria are similar as in ICD-10. In addition, the fire setting is not done for monetary gain, for example, insurance fraud, as an expression of socio-political ideology, to conceal criminal activity, to express anger or vengeance, or to improve one's living circumstances. And the fire setting should not occur in the context of an underlying psychiatric cause. So, fire setting can occur in the context of these psychiatric causes, but it would not be called pyromania. So, the disorders which can be associated with fire setting include psychosis, mania, drug intoxication, conduct disorder, antisocial personality disorder and intellectual disability. Triggers for an episode of fire setting in pyromania include feeling stressed, boredom, recent interpersonal conflict. Although there is relief immediately after the fire setting, many experience severe distress later. These individuals have an abnormal fascination with fires. They may take on fire safety volunteering roles in the workplace or even join the fire service. They typically act alone and do not operate in gangs. They have a tendency to follow fire engines to the site of fires. As fire setting is usually committed alone without any witnesses, only a minority of arsonists get arrested or convicted. So most cases of pyromania are undetected. Some may come to the attention of psychiatric services, example, during the trial of a person charged with arson. Even if pyromania is identified, evidence for treatment efficacy is limited. Treatment options include antidepressants, mood stabilizers, antipsychotics, and psychotherapy. Antiandrogens may be considered in the small subgroup of pyromaniacs who report sexual arousal from fire setting. The next topic is testamentary capacity. This refers to the ability of an individual to make a valid will. The person making the will is called a testator. The testator should be of sound mind at the time of making the will and should have the independence to decide the contents of the will. Even if the testator has a mental illness, as long as the will is not directly influenced by symptoms, the will is still considered valid. A validly executed will may be contested in a court of law by those who feel that they did not receive their expected due share. In such cases, the burden of proof lies with the contestants who would need to establish the invalidity of the will. Testamentary capacity is also called sound and disposing mind and memory. Testamentary capacity around the world is still broadly based on the judgment delivered in 1870 in Britain in the Banks versus Goodfellow case. The will made by John Banks, in which he left his property to his niece, was contested by his son on the grounds that the father had mental illness. The judge ruled that Banks had testamentary capacity despite being deluded, as the delusions did not directly influence the contents of the will. So the will was declared valid. The criteria for testamentary capacity are also called the Banks versus Goodfellow test. So the testator must be capable of a basic understanding of the nature and effect of the will, the extent of his property or estate, the claims of those who expect to benefit from the will. The testator should not have a mental illness that influences him or her to make bequests in the will that they would not have otherwise included. The testamentary capacity is specific to the making of the will. All testators are assumed to have sound mind unless proven otherwise. In complex cases, it is good practice to get the testamentary capacity certified by a psychiatrist at the time of the will in order to reduce the risk of future challenges. A will can be declared invalid even if the testator had capacity, if it can be shown that the will was drawn up under undue influence. Undue influence can be exerted physically or psychologically and can coerce the testator to change the contents of the will to benefit the influencer. Factors suggesting undue influence include: the influencer deliberately isolating the testator from other closer family members or long-term friends. The attorney involved is known only to the influencer and not the testator. The influencer benefiting disproportionately from the will. The testator being helplessly dependent on or susceptible to the influencer. If a will is challenged on the grounds of undue influence, the burden of proof is on the contestants to establish the same. This brings us to our final topic, risk assessment. In general psychiatry, risk assessment is mainly concerned with risk to self. In forensic psychiatry, risk assessment is mainly concerned with risk to others or dangerousness. For any risk assessment to be useful, it is important to have a plan in place to try to manage and reduce the risks that are identified. But this is easier said than done, as risk is influenced by a number of factors that may be well beyond the control of psychiatric services. As the baseline prevalence of serious violence in the general population is usually very low, most risk assessment tools have low positive predictive value, that is, they have many false positives, which would mean that only a small proportion of the individuals identified as dangerous would go on to commit a serious offense. An ideal risk assessment would have the following features: a clear, validated definition of the risk that is being assessed, access to all the data which would enable identification of all potentially relevant factors related to that risk, being able to come to a confident conclusion about the likelihood or probability of the specific risk event occurring within a specific time frame. In real life, however, risk assessment is almost never so straightforward. There are many scales used in forensic psychiatry for risk assessment. Examples are the Psychopathy Checklist Revised, PCLR, Historical, Clinical and Risk Management Scale, HCR20, and the Violence Risk Appraisal Guide, or the VRAG. The PCL was devised by Robert Hare, a Canadian psychologist. The PCLR, which is the revised version, has 20 items, each rated on a scale of 0 to 2, so a maximum score of 40. A score of 25 or above is usually suggestive of psychopathy. The following are some of the characteristics that are rated in the items: glibness and superficial charm, pathological lying, lack of remorse or guilt, impulsivity, promiscuous sexual behavior. There is a screening version called PCLSV, which has 12 items. The current version of the HCR20 is the third version, or V3. It was developed by Douglas and colleagues, again psychologists from Canada. There are 20 items divided into three groups: 10 historical items relating to the past, 5 clinical items pertaining to the present, and 5 risk management items concerned with the future. For example, the item H1 relates to violence, C1 to insight, R1 to professional services and plans. Risk in each item is rated as either low, moderate or high. HCR20 is an example of a structured professional judgment tool, and it does not use cutoff scores. The VRAG was developed again by Canadian psychologists, Harris and colleagues. It is an actuarial risk assessment tool and gives a numerical probability of risk. An actuary is an insurance industry professional who analyzes data estimates risks and decides on the insurance premium. The VRAG has 12 items, each with a different weightage. Some of the items are: item 1 is the psychopathy checklist screening version score. Item 3 is a DSM diagnosis of personality disorder. Item 9 is a DSM diagnosis of schizophrenia. And item 11 is related to alcohol misuse. Before we conclude, let us go through 5 multiple choice questions. Question 1. Which of the following types of stalkers is more commonly a female than a male? I have given 4 options. Please go through them and select your choice. And the correct answer is A. Intimacy seeking stalker is more commonly a female than a male. The other 3 types of stalkers are more commonly males. Question 2. Which of the following is concerned with the assessment of testamentary capacity? There are 4 options. Please go through them and select your choice. And the correct answer is A. Banks vs. Goodfellow test. This is concerned with testamentary capacity. The Dusky criteria is concerned with competence to stand trial, which is a concept used in the US. The McNaughton rules relate to insanity defense, while the Pritchard criteria are concerned with fitness to plead. Question 3. Which of the following is an example of an actuarial risk assessment tool? Is it the HCR20, the PCLR, or the VRAG? And the correct answer is VRAG. So VRAG is an actuarial risk assessment tool. The other 2 are also risk assessment tools, but they are not actuarial. VRAG stands for Violence Risk Appraisal Guide. Question 4. Which of the following is not correct regarding mental disorders and violence? There are 4 options. Please go through the options and select your choice. If you want, you can pause at this stage. And the correct answer is D. D is not correct regarding mental disorders and violence. Treatment significantly reduces the risk of violence. So the other three options are correct. The final question, which of the following is correct regarding pyromania? Please go through the options and select your choice. And the correct answer is B. Pyromania is a diagnosis that is included in both ICD-10 and DSM-5. A is false because it is the other way around. Pyromaniacs are a subset among arsonists. C is false because pyromania is characterized by a feeling of tension before the fire setting and relief from that tension after fire setting. And D is false because pyromaniacs tend to act alone. That brings us to the end of this presentation. Hope you found the information useful. Thank you for watching.